I have many comments to make about Mr. Donald Trump, but after all, he is the duly elected president by the American people, so we respect their collective decision. And as far as Mr. Trump's relationship with Japan is concerned, I would say he's a good president. The good president, in my definition, in our definition, is someone who prioritizes on security affairs rather than economic affairs, who doesn't make abrasive economic demands. And so far, thanks to the help of three generals, especially Mr. Mattis, Mr. Trump is perceived as a good president for Japan. On the other hand, if I can be blunt, we are a little bit disappointed with the inaction of President Obama in Asian theater, which we believe has emboldened China's ambition to go outward, especially its expansionary maritime strategy towards the South China Sea, East China Sea, and to the Pacific. We have been always protected and supported by the defense people in Washington more than any other group else. And so we still feel that we are in the good hands of the wisdom of those defense clan. As far as economic aspect is concerned, yes, Mr. Trump did walk out of TPP, but Japan, as you know, has started to coalesce around the remaining 11 members to form TPP-11, which, if everything goes smoothly, we will come to near conclusion by the end of this year. At which point, we hope the United States will reconsider its position. For one thing, for instance, American farmers will be at a very disadvantageous position if the United States does not come in. According to TPP, our final tariff, for instance, on beef will be 9%, which the Australians will enjoy, of course. Whereas if the United States doesn't come in, they will be taxed at 38%, the current rate. So if they don't come in quickly, Japanese market will be swept by Australian beef. Mr. Trump's or the United States' most serious concern is North Korea. It is the same thing for Japan. It is our highest national security agenda. The problem is that this young, reckless, erratic dictator almost coming to the point of acquiring ICBMs capable of reaching the continental United States with nuclear warheads. The pace of the preparation is very, very impressive. This year alone, young Kim Jong-un has shot 15 missiles, including the failed ones. And since he came to power, he shot 94 missiles, as compared to what his father and grandfather did during the 25 years term, 61 missiles shot. And the pace with which Mr. Kim Jong-un is experimenting has been speeding up. I think the international sanctions has at last come to take effect, slowly but steadily. And Mr. Kim Jong-un, before he is completely choked economically, has to have the weapons in his hand. That's my personal thinking. Of course, he aims to have these weapons in order to have the subsequent negotiations. as a nuclear state with the United States at an advantageous conditions. But my conjecture is that he has further ambitions of unifying the peninsula, the abortive dream of his respectful grandfather, so that he will be able to say, hey, United States, don't you intervene this time. You know what will happen if you do this time. Mr. Abe and Mr. Trump are in very good terms. As a matter of fact, they are playing golf together tomorrow. And I think Mr. Abe's role is to stand by President Trump, because this nuclear problem with North Korea will be a long, long game. After North Korea has acquired a de facto nuclear state status, we will have to beef up our retaliatory capability at a massive scale as a means of deterring their temptation to use those weapons, and also to build a credible nuclear, a credible missile defense system. And I think we will have to spend a long time before they are coming to a normal state. Thank you.